Good evening, First Baptist Church, to all of our members and our friends and family members near and far. We want to thank you for another Bible study night. We hope that this lesson has really resonated your heart, that it has encouraged you to do what needs to get done before Christ returns. We don't know when he's going to return. This is why we are going over this lesson, because we want people to really get their hearts and minds in alignment with Christ and his kingdom. I want to encourage you, if you have not gotten your life in alignment with the kingdom, if you have not been in a relationship with Christ, if you've fallen out of fellowship with him, I want to encourage you to make that a point of urgency. Make it a point of urgency, because Christ is coming. People are saying that he's coming. We see signs that he's coming. We know that there are strange things in the air. People are talking about, you know, aliens and all like that. We don't know about all that, but we do know that the things that he pointed out in scripture, those things are transpiring before us today. So I just want to encourage you and hope that this lesson blesses you in your preparation to reconnect and whatever you need to do to get your hearts and minds right with God through Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Father God, we just want to thank you for this time together. We want to thank you for this Bible study. And Father, we pray, Lord, that it would reach the heart, it would reach the soul. Because Father, we know that when your son comes, when you finally tell him to come and close it out, Father, we want to be ready and we want to be prepared, Lord, to go with him. And we want to enter into your kingdom, Father, where we can be with you forever, never to be separated again. We pray you forgive our sins, forgive our iniquities and our transgressions. And Lord, forgive us for sins of commission and omission. And Lord, we ask that you just continue to strengthen us where we're weak, build us up where we're torn down. And Lord, give us sight and insight and foresight. Because Lord, we want our lives and our spirits and our households to be in alignment with you. Because we know when you're coming. We don't know when and where, but we know that you are. We pray, Lord, that you would bless the sick among us, bless the bereaved among us, bless those, Lord, who just need you to continue to show yourself strong to them and to let them know, Lord, that you are with them and you promise never, ever to leave them. Bless us as we go forth in this Bible study lesson. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Amen. Now we're going to hear a song from Sister Walker.
Jesus, 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 Jesus. Oh,
Amen, amen. We want to thank Sister Walker for that beautiful selection, Jesus Keep Me Near the Cross. Amen. We need to be near the cross. We need to remind ourselves of the sacrifice that Jesus Christ has made on our behalf, and we need to forever be mindful of that cross. Thank you, Sister Walker, for that spiritual selection. This is week four of our Bible selection, and we have been talking about how do we know the return of Jesus Christ is near? How do we know the return of Jesus Christ is near? Well, all we have to do is look around and pay attention to the signs of the times. And Jesus told us the signs of the times, watch out because know that I'm near. And so, as I said before, this should not be a time of sadness, a time of melancholy, a time of grief. It ought to be a time of rejoicing. It ought to be a time when our hearts really rejoices that Christ is coming and all of the things and the evil and the injustice and all of the things that we go through, those things will be over because Christ is coming to establish his kingdom. His millennial kingdom here on earth. And you and I are going to be part of his kingdom. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah for that, because we're going to be part of that kingdom of which our lives will be forever. We will have eternal life with him. Can you imagine having peace and joy forever? And the joy bells are unending. That's going to be a wonderful time for all of us who really follow Jesus Christ. Like the Bible says that their eyes have not seen and the ears have not heard, neither has it entered the hearts or the imagination of man, the good things the Lord has for them that love him. So we can't even put it in words, the good things he has for us. But we must make sure that we are prepared and ready for his coming. Our introduction says, and we want to make sure that you read along with me, are we living in the midst of the signs of the return of Jesus Christ? The answer is a resounding yes. What the scripture mentioned centuries ago is happening in real time before us. We do well to pay attention to the signs and remain faithful and obedient to the teachings of the gospel of Jesus Christ and his apostles. Before Jesus Christ returns a second time, prophets spoke about what would be occurring before Jesus Christ returned. What would be the moral conditions of the world before the return of Jesus Christ? Everything we see in our nation and around the world has been prophesied to happen. And as crazy as things are in our world, we should rejoice because our Lord's coming is near. We don't know the exact time of Christ's return. In fact, nobody knows, not even Jesus Christ. But concerning that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, nor the Son, but the Father only. We find it in Matthew 24 and 36. Therefore, we should not delay in doing his will, because he may come when we least expect him. We find that 24, 42 through 44. Knowing the signs of the times should help us be effective witnesses to those who don't know Jesus Christ and are skeptical about his return to take over the world. Jesus says, now, learn this lesson from the fig tree. As soon as its twigs get tender and its leaves come out, you know that summer is near. So rejoice, saints, rejoice, people of God. Our Lord's coming draws near. Now, why am I bringing up this lesson? Because I think that we have made following Christ a religion. This is not about religion. This is about having a relationship with Jesus Christ. This is not participating in some worldwide ethical way of doing things. This is being a follower of Jesus Christ. People say, well, you know, Christianity is just along all these other religions. Christ never told us to be a Christian. He never told us, I want you to identify yourself as a Christian. No, they were first called Christians at Antioch. They didn't call themselves that. Other folks called them that. Why did they call them that? Because they were faithful and obedient to the teachings and the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's why they were living like Christ. They were performing miracles like Christ. They were preaching like Christ. They were facing circumstances like Christ. They were talking about the kingdom like Christ. Everything Christ did, even in their flawed, defected characters at times, they reminded people of Jesus Christ. The question for us, are we reminding people of Jesus Christ, or are we reminding people that we are Baptist, or we are Methodist, or we are Presbyterian, or we some denomination? We should not be trying to remind people of a denomination, but we ought to be reminding people of a personality, of a man who came to this earth and radically changed everything. A man who came to this earth to die for our sins, and a man who rose from the dead and became the first fruits of the living. So our job in this world as agents of the kingdom of God is not to remind people of a religion or a denomination. Our job in this world is to remind people of a personality who happens to be Jesus Christ, a king who has a kingdom that he wants to give us and died for us to have that kingdom, to enter into that kingdom and to enjoy that kingdom forevermore. Again, we have to be ready. We have to be effective witnesses. We have to cut through the chase of all of the things that keep people from entering into the kingdom. Jesus told the Pharisees, you don't want to enter, and you are blocking others that want to enter. And so therefore, let us not be guilty of holding up anything else other than the person Christ for people to come into the kingdom of God. We have to be ready, because religion is not going to come and rescue us. It's going to be a person. Jesus Christ is coming, and he's not coming to be represented as Judaism. He's not coming to be represented as Christianity or as Muslim or as any other religion. He's coming as King. He's coming as King of King. He's coming as Lord of Lord. Has nothing to do with your denomination. And if you don't believe in him, if you don't have a relationship with him, if you're not obeying him, it does not matter what you call yourselves. If you're Baptist, if you're outside of Christ, you will be separated from God forever. If you're Methodist, if you're Presbyterian, whatever your denomination affiliation may be, if you are operating and living outside the obedience of Jesus Christ, then your denomination, your religion cannot save you. So this is what we have to do. We have to be effective witnesses so that people can understand this in its most simple form, because Christ gave it to us simply. He took commandments and reduced them down to two. He talked about two kingdoms. Either we're going to be a kingdom, part of his kingdom, or the kingdom of this world. He talked about two churches. Either we're going to be part of the church of God, or we're going to be part of the synagogue of Satan. Christ made it, Jesus made it as simple as he could. Let us not take that which he made simple and complicate it because we want to control some academic category, or we want to control terms or no terms that other people may not know. That's not our purpose as Christians. But we know he's coming, and we have to be ready for that return. All right, we're going to get into our scriptures. And this is going to be read by Deaconess Wright. And she's going to be reading for us 2 Thessalonians, the 2nd chapter, 3 through 8.
Good evening, and may God continue to bless all of us. Let no one deceive you by any means, for that day will not come unless the falling away comes first, and the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. 5. Do you not remember that when I was still with you, I told you these things? And now you know what is restraining, that he may be revealed in his own time. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains will do so until he is taken out of the way. And then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord will consume with the breath of his mouth and destroy with the brightness of his coming.
Amen. Thank you, Deaconess Wright, for reading us these two scriptures. Here we see that Paul is talking to the Thessalonians, because we got to remember at the time that Paul and the early Christians and the apostles were preaching and teaching, they had what we call mystery religions. There were a whole lot of teaching going on. And this is why the gospel had to be preached. And this is why the apostles, the disciples, and the early Christians were persecuted, because there were so many religions being taught. So Paul was telling the Thessalonians, let no one deceive you by any means, for that day would not come unless there's a falling away comes first. And we see that today. You know, we see that today. We see that Christians, or so-called Christians, have fallen away. So many people have fallen away from the faith. We've fallen away from the church. We've fallen away from our obligations. We've fallen away from our commitment to the church, our commitment to even our own families and our own children, raising our children, all of the things that we held dear at one time, all the values that we once had and embraced. Society was much better. But now we have fallen away from so many values, from so many things, and we can see the results of why our society, our nation, and the world are in the condition they are in, because we've fallen away. We've fallen away from the traditions, the moral traditions that were passed down to us from generation to generation. We've fallen away from the idea of marriage. We've fallen away from the things that the Bible teaches us to do and not to do. We've fallen away that the light that we used to allow to shine, we have now put it under a bushel. It's almost like we are embarrassed to let our light shine. Not that these things didn't go on before, but we can see it in mass now. We can see it in mass now, because so many generations, from the X generation and the generations behind that, they came to church, but they're not connected with the church. So many people don't want to come to church anymore. So many people just have fallen away from the fellowship. So Paul was telling the Thessalonians that the day will not come unless first there's a what? A falling away. And the man of sin is revealed. We're talking about Satan. We're talking about the one who at the beginning wanted humanity to never be in relationship with God. So the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worship. We know that Satan. We know that Satan and the demons are operating in our culture, in our land, in our nation, in the world like never before. Okay? And he's being revealed, and we see him. We see him for who he is. So when we start asking, oh my goodness, we got a whole lot of mental illness out there. We got to treat people. Of course we do. But behind the mental illness that people just kill, just indiscriminately kill people for no reason. Yes, we know that's mental illness, but what's causing that mental illness? It is the what? It is the son of perdition. It is the doctrines of what? The demons. And they get into people and they cause people to act irrational. They cause people to have no self-control. They cause people to do things that if they were in their right minds, they never would do it. Well, why do you say that? Why you say that, Pastor? Well, that was mental illness back in that time. Even the time of Jesus, you remember when Jesus went to Gadara and he came upon a man who made his place in the graveyard, and he lived among the tombs, and how he would cry out loud, and how nobody could restrain him, and how he would break loose and do all kinds of crazy things. But when he came to Jesus, you know, he said, "Now, Jesus, why do you come to vex us? Why do you come to bother us?" And Jesus asked, "Well, what is your name?" He said, "Well, my name is Legion." In other words, that all of those foul, demonic, unclean spirits were all housed in one man. And that was causing that man, or that young man rather, to do some very irrational things. No sane person would be living in the graveyard. No sane person would be cutting themselves. No sane person would be doing what he, and nobody could control him because he had that demonic, unclean spirit strength. And so therefore, people were sort of afraid of him, okay? But he met the king, he met Christ. And Christ asked him, what's your name? He said, "My name is Demas. My name is Legion." I mean, many of us. So we know that when Christ called those demons out, what did those demons say? Don't send us out of the region. So look, there's some swine eating over. Let us go over there and get in the swine. And Christ gave them permission to go get in the swine. But guess what? You had to come out of the human being. You had to come out of the child of God. All right? And the Bible says that after those foul, unclean, demonic spirits came out of that young man, they went into the swine. The swine ran over the steep, and they all got drowned. But the Bible then described the young man, said that what he was, what he was now in his right mind. So as long as we have the son of perdition, as long as we have demonic spirits operating in people, they will do irrational things. They will do things that we can't wrap our heads around, because what? We got something else that's at play. And that is, we still have demonic spirits possessing people. So we do know that that is the son of perdition. Those things are being revealed even today. So who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worship? You say, anytime we don't want to obey God, anytime we want to live contrary to God, anytime we want to supplant something that God says that this is what I want you to do, and you supplant that with somebody, something else, you are actually exalting yourself to be above God. When God gives us a definition of family and we come with another definition of family, then we are exalting ourselves above God. When God gives us the definition between a husband and a wife, and we come along with another definition of what marriage means, same-sex marriage and all that, you are exalting yourself above God. Anything. It's not just the same sex. It's not just the gay and home. It's anything, anything, anything that God says that we oppose, that we go against, anything that God puts into place, we take it down and put something else in place. We are actually being led and counseled in all the what? We are the tools of the devil, okay? And it's not about our feelings. Christ didn't save us about our feelings. Christ didn't give his life because of his feelings. He gave his life because of his love for us. So once we can get rid of our feelings and put in place our obedience, our feelings will catch up. This is not about your feelings and my feelings. This is not about what you think, and this is not about our theological and philosophical mind. This is about the mind of God that was lived throughout Jesus Christ, who came to teach us about the kingdom, who brought us a gospel to enter us into that kingdom, and who's also coming back based on that gospel. And he's coming back, but while he is away, he established the church to oppose. He established the church to disobey. He established the church to make sure that we what? That we resist the devil. We resist his philosophy. We resist everything about him because we know that he wants and he is busy opposing and exalting himself above that which is called God and that which is worship, so that he sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Now, this is also meaning that as the nation of Israel is now a new nation and was formed in 1948, it's going to come a time when the son of perdition is going to exalt himself, and he's going to get with the Jews, those who've been blinded. He's going to get with them. He's going to allow them to start making sacrifices again. I'm talking about right now in Israel, in Jerusalem. And while they're doing all this, he's going to stop it. He's going to let them go for about 3.5 years, then he's going to stop it. Then it says that he's going to go into the temple. He's going to go into the temple, and he's going to sit on the throne, and he's going to claim himself to be God. But there will be some things going on. The world economy is going into a downspin. And then that's when they start talking about all of the things that's going to happen. And we're going to see later on, we start talking about the 666 mark. All of those things are going to happen. But then this Antichrist person is going to come. And he's going to straighten it all out. And he's going to present himself as this great savior. And people are going to start believing in him. People are going to start embracing him. It's almost like we're getting a tidbit of that already. You know, there are some people whose lives are so filled with criminality, and it doesn't matter what they do, they still get so much support from people. And if we don't watch it, that person just may get back in office again. I do not understand how somebody can have that much criminality against them. Be convicted and all of the things, but yet there's some people who still believe in him. But that's a tidbit of what is to come. So we know that he's going to go into the temple and he's going to sit down and he's going to say he's God. Okay. Then Paul goes on to say, but do you not remember that when I was still with you, I told you these things? And now you know what is restraining, that he may be what revealed in his own time. That time is now. We are living in that time now. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Y'all know what lawlessness means? It means doing whatever you want to do, regardless of what the law says. We got politicians doing whatever they want to do, regardless of what the law says. We got people in society violating the law. We are living in a world of lawlessness, of which people are totally disregarding the moral law. They are disregarding the spiritual law. They are disregarding the natural law. They are disregarding every law because they're doing what they want to do, just like they did in the times of Noah. They were lawless people. We are living in lawless times. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains will do so until he's taken out of the way. And what is that being restrained now until he's taken? He's talking about the church. When we are taken, I've said this before, the only thing that's in the way of Satan and the demons of hell, that's the church. We are in his way because of our moral stance, because of our relationship with Jesus Christ. He can't totally take over. And since he can't totally take over, he's working hard. He's working hard to get the church to give in to him. He's working hard, slowly, subconsciously, in ways that are slick. He's slowly trying to infiltrate the church. And I would venture to say he's already in the church. But there are a few of us who are still standing. There are a few of us who are still faithful. There are a few of us who are still resisting. There are a few of us who don't mind suffering for the sake of Christ. So therefore, we're restraining him. We're restraining him. God is working through us. He's being restrained until the church is taken out of the way. And when the church is taken out of the way, then it said, and then the lawless one will be revealed. Then the lawless one will be revealed. Because right now, the church is in his way. He's still working. He's in the government. He's in every institution of society. But something is in his way, and that's you and me. That's the postmodern church. That's the church as a universal church. And then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord will consume with the breath of his mouth and destroy him with the brightness of his coming. So you see, the Lord don't really have to just come and get into a fist fight with the devil. He's already defeated him. And when he comes, he's going to do what? He's going to destroy him with the brightness of his coming. That's why Jesus says that men love darkness more than light. But when he comes, that brightness is going to destroy Satan and his works in the earth. So I want us to understand that lawlessness is now a reality among us. People are doing some of everything. Pastors are doing some of everything. Politicians are doing some of everything. I mean, teachers are doing some of everything. I mean, in every profession, you find people violating the law. You find people who don't care nothing about the law. They're going to do it anyway until they get caught. And then when they get caught, they're going to try to find somebody to get them out of being held accountable for it. But I just wanted to point out to you that we are living in those times. We're living in those times of lawlessness. I have never seen in my life people violating the law. People are mass shooting. You don't care nothing about the law of life. You know, thou shalt not kill. That's a law. That's a moral law. But you just indiscriminately just kill people. You indiscriminately destroy people. You're passing laws and passing policies that destroy people. You don't care. You're in a position where you got power and you're just abusing that power, and you are pushing and advancing and advocating lawlessness in the world. Let's move on. All right, let's move on. And this will be read by Sister Sheila Small, 2 Corinthians 2:9 through 12.
2 Thessalonians 2:9 through 12. The coming of the lawless one is according to the working of Satan, with all power, signs, and lying wonders, and with all unrighteous deception among those who perish, because they did not receive the love of the truth that they might be saved. And for this reason, God will send them strong delusion, that they should believe the lie, that they all may be condemned who did not believe the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness.
Thank you. Thank you. Now we see right here, he's talking about the lawless one. It's in blue, workings of Satan, false signs and wonders. You see, the enemy, Satan has to copy what God does, to fool people, to deceive people, to destroy people. He's a common copy. He wants to always copy what God does, but his intentions are different. Okay? So we said the coming of the lawless one is according to the working of Satan. And I tell people all the time, the devil and the demons of hell, they have powers too. And it says, and with all power, signs, and lying wonders. They're gonna be performing stuff, making you think, okay? Making you think that they are of the kingdom of God and they are not. And with all unrighteous deception, it's a whole lot of deception going on. Whole lot of deception. I mean, people now, I've just seen it on Facebook a lot. I just don't see how people could believe that stuff. You know, you can wave your coat and it's almost like the Holy Spirit is slaying people in the spirit and they falling all out and folks getting behind them. Well, look, it tells me all this is already staged. You've already planned this. So why do you need to stand behind somebody if you already did not anticipate that they go fall? So all that stuff is staged to fool people, to get people to believe in your ministry or what you're doing. That is, listen, all of those things that we see are of the devil. Now, you might say, well, Pastor, not all of it. Well, if I saw one time a guy didn't have no legs. He didn't have no legs at all. And they brought him up. And that was a way to really expose this so-called prophet or this so-called pastor who were making people get up, walk out of their wheelchairs. So they brought one guy up and he had no legs at all, but they had a coat over his legs. And that pastor was going through all kinds of gestures and prayers and methods and incantations and all like that. And he said, now I want you to get up because God just told me you're going to walk today. You're going to walk today. And you're going to do it, Decay, because I know God is working through me to give you a miracle today. And when they removed the coat from the man's legs, he didn't know what else to say. And he was just in for his workers to get him off stage, because there was nothing he could do. So I'm just saying that there are all kind of gimmicks that people come up with. Now, does that mean that God does not perform miracles? No. God still performs miracles. But what this scripture is talking about, we have to be careful. We have to be careful because the devil will be performing miracles with all power, signs, and lying wonders. It's going to blow your mind. It's going to blow people's mind. And with all unrighteous deception, he's doing it to deceive among those who perish, because they did not receive the love of the truth. We're talking about people that haven't received the love of the truth. They have not received the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. They the ones going to be fooled. The ones who are so critical of the church. The ones who are so critical of the Bible. The ones who always want to do what they want to do in the name of love, because they do not want to receive the love of the truth. That they might be what? That they might be saved. So when we give people the truth, when we tell people what God's word says, and it contradicts their lifestyle, whatever they are doing, however way they are living, people will say, well, I'm not gonna have anything to do with y'all. I'm not gonna have anything to do with the church because y'all are not about love. That is all about love. God's word is all about love. For God so loved the world, he gave, but there's what? There's a standard. There's a truth. And there are absolutes that we have to embrace and confess and teach so that what? So that people can know the truth. So that people can know the truth. But these are the people who did not receive the love of the truth that they might be saved. And for this reason, and because they didn't receive it, God gonna send something to them. In other words, God gonna help you to go to hell. Now that's just me saying that, but he's just saying a spirit of delusion. And for this reason, God will send them strong delusion that they should believe the lie. It's gonna what? God is gonna back up and let the spirit of delusion fall upon people so that people can actually believe the lie. And that's sad. And we got people like that today. They are actually believing the lie and you can't talk them out of it. You can't talk them out of it. That they should what? Believe the lie, that they all may be consumed who did not believe the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. And it is a shame that there are churches that are allowing certain things to go on because what? They are promoting certain things just to have a following, and they what? And they do not believe the truth and have pleasure in unrighteousness. Now, I am not saying this. This is scripture saying this. I'm just trying to point out to you all what is going on, even as I speak today. We just had, I was at a minister's prayer breakfast, and this church split because they would not give in to the culture. They would not get into the culture. And so I guess it was the bishop or whoever was over the church told them, y'all got to go then. 95% of the people left. And so while we were praying for this pastor, afterwards, he disclosed to me, he said, you know, we just don't have the spiritual authority to change the scriptures. We don't have the spiritual authority to change anything that God has put in place. And I said, you are right not to do it. Even if you have to suffer, even if you have to suffer for it, do what's right, because the enemy, the devil, is at work. He's at work, and he is trying his best to what? To infiltrate the church and change the truth of God into a lie. And those who do not accept the truth, embrace the truth, walk in the truth, they are the ones that's going to be the victims of this delusion that they should believe a lie. And they all going to be condemned who did not believe the truth and had pleasure in them. See, the truth has none. Listen, the truth ain't got nothing to do with your feelings. See, the truth has nothing to do with your feelings. Nothing. Because people's feelings are hurt, they reject the truth. No, truth has nothing to do with your feelings. Because when you're feeling good in sin and truth comes along to bring you out of sin, that's what? You don't feel good about that. But if you want to have life and have it more abundantly, you better come on out of that. That you might what? That you might partake in eternal life that Christ gives. So I'm trying to get people to understand it's not about your feelings. It's about accepting the truth. When you accept the truth and Christ brings you out, bring your soul out of the kingdom of this world into the kingdom of God, your feelings will eventually catch up. In fact, you're going to be rejoicing after you see where you came from and where you are now. But I'm just telling y'all right now, this is going on. People are believing a lie, and they are perpetrating a lie, and a delusion is, that's why we had January the 6th. That's what happened, because people believe that the election was stolen. And based upon that lie, look at what happened on January 6th. And now you got people who are convicted, put in jail because they believe the lie. We got people believing conspiracy theories. No facts, but it's just a lie. And because they believe the lie, delusion comes, and they think they're doing right because they won't accept the truth. Regardless of how much you bring it up to them, regardless of how much you communicate to them, they're going to believe what they're going to believe. Well, that's the delusion coming. That's the delusion that's already at work. And that's the same thing that's happening, not only in the political realm, but it's also happening in the church realm. Let's move on. Now, let's have a discussion. Why believe a lie when you can believe the truth of Jesus Christ? How can we maintain our spiritual walk with Jesus Christ and avoid the lies of Satan? The lies of Satan. Satan is still lying. Jesus called him the father of lies. He's still lying. And anytime he tells you something that's different than what God told you, that's a lie. Don't believe it. Don't embrace it. Don't walk in it. So why believe a lie when we can believe the truth of Jesus Christ? Talk to me while this video is playing. Y'all pick it up.
Walk with me, Lord. Walk with me. Walk with me, Lord. Why don't you walk with me? While I'm on this Jesus journey, I need you, Jesus, to walk with me. Be my friend, Lord. Be my friend. Be my friend, Lord. Why don't you be my friend? While I'm on this tedious journey, I need you, Jesus, to be my friend. Don't leave me alone, Lord. Don't leave me alone, Lord. Please don't leave me alone. While I'm on this tedious journey, I need your Jesus to walk with me.
Come on and play it, Anthony.
All right, we do have some things in the chat.
All right,
let's see here. All right, move this up. Why do we believe lie? Because we want the lie to be true because it fits our agenda. Amen. When the lie is self-serving, it seems okay to accept the lie.
Wow.
Use the Bible as our reference instead of man's words. So that's how we can maintain our spiritual walk.
Yes.
Sister Bell says, we have to be steadfast in God's word, which is truth.
Yes.
Sister Doswell, by reading the Bible and trusting in his word.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes. Amen. Thank you all. Beautiful song. On target comments, because again, that's what it's going to take to avoid the lies of the devil. And when you tell people the truth, you don't have to tell them in a way that's nasty. You don't have to tell them in a way that is unloving and unkind. You just tell them, listen, this is not the way God would want us to walk. This is not the way God would want us to live. God gave us certain rules and regulations. He gave us commandments. And he wants us to embrace those commandments. And those commandments are not grievous. He wants the best for us. He understands the way. We don't know the way. That's why he sent his son. And Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. So when you tell people the truth, you don't have to get into an argument with them. You can just say, hey, this is what God's word says. And I pray that you embrace it in a way that you will see that God truly loves you and that he's trying to form a relationship with you and he's trying to wash you and he's trying to condition you so that you can enter into his kingdom and live with him forever. And so again, there's a way we can witness to people. There's a way we can love people. Because sometimes the way how we do it, sometimes it's very ineffective and that this may turn people off. We want to be able to get people to embrace what we are saying through God's word and leave the rest up to the word and the spirit. All right, let's move on. And we're going to have our next scripture, and this is going to be read by Minister Willie Mae Howard.
He caused all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and slaves, to receive a mark on their right hand or on their forehead, and that no one may buy or sell except one who has the mark of the name of the beast or the number of his name. Here is wisdom. Let him who has understanding calculate the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man. His number is 666.
Amen. Thank you, Minister Willie Mae Howard, for reading this scripture for us. Again, just like I said, when the son of perdition is revealed, and as we begin to see the signs of lawlessness in our land and all over the world, it's getting to the point, and I have seen signs of this, how they're going to put a chip in your hands or somewhere on your body that's going to have all the information they need about you. Every time you walk in the store and there's a barcode, those things are the groundwork for such thing to happen because, you know, technology is moving very fast. I just heard today in probably around 2030 or 2035, cell phones will probably be, obsolete because there's no going to be no need for it because now they are making chips that they can put right into your body. Even when someone wants to call you, it can alarm you somehow and you can answer your hand. Now, how that's going to be, I don't know, but this is coming. This technology is coming, and it's talking about he causes all. We're talking about the son of perdition. We're talking about Satan, the defeated one, the one who's fooling people now, the one who's in the culture now, trying to get the church and the society and the nations of the world to oppose everything about God. He is at work now. He causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and slave, to receive a mark on their right hand or on their forehead. Well, what is that mark? You know? Well, he could further fool us because whatever chip they began to put on people, now people gonna probably be conscious of the 666, but they might not see 666. 666 may be inside the circuit board. It may be inside the little chip. And he's going to have that mark, whatever that mark looks like. I don't know. Whatever the mark looks like, whether it's going to be some kind of mark, some kind of chip, some kind of little small device. And he's going to do what? He's going to get them to receive this mark. And this is going to be mandatory. There's not going to be no voting on this. It's not, democracy will probably be gone. And we're doing a good job in America of killing democracy. So democracy would probably be already gone. And it said that no one may be able to buy or sell except one who has the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. This is the only way you're going to be able to operate in the system. It's the only way you're going to be able to go and buy groceries. The things you and I do now, we're not going to be able to do those things unless we got the mark on us, unless the mark of the beast is somewhere on us, either on our what? On our hand or in our foreheads. Because that information gives the information to the system or those who are controlling the system, everything they need to know about you. We're moving away from paper now. Everything is digital. Everything is technology now. Okay? So I want you to understand that. That's coming. That's in the works right now. Okay? And then it says that except you're not going to be able to buy, sell, do any business. You're not going to be able to buy a house. You're not going to be able to go to the grocery store. You're not going to be able to go to the doctor. All of the basic things we do to live in this society as we are living today, which requires us to buy, sell, whatever we do, we're not going to be able to do that unless we have that mark on our hand or in our forehead. And that's going to be mandatory. But then, this is what John is telling us, but here's the wisdom. Let him who has understanding calculate the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and his number is 666. It's going to be the number of a man, 666. Mm-hmm. And that we know is the mark of the beast. We know that is the mark of the devil. We know that that is the mark in which the devil will use to control all economics, all systems, all people. And unless you have that mark, he's going to kill you. And this is also going to be a time of great persecution. It's going to be a time of, if you decide, I don't want that mark, I don't want to receive it, he just going to say, we're just going to kill him. I mean, your life is not going to mean anything to him. Only thing that's going to mean anything to the devil is being over systems, being over nations, being over people, having total control. That's all he ever wanted. Okay? That's all he's ever wanted. He's wanted to be God. He's always wanted to be God. At the very outset, that's how he fooled the other angels. You know, when the Bible talks about when he said, I want my throne above the Most High God. And that's where that galactical warfare came into place. When he launched an attack against God and his kingdom, he lost. And I've taught that to you all before. He lost and he was kicked out of heaven. And the Bible says, woe to the earth and to the sea, for the dragon has been kicked out. Whoa, what that mean? Watch out. Because he's what? He's ruined. He's like a roaring lion, seeing whom he can devour. At this point in human history, he's going to be devouring people. And because we're so used to technology, because we're so comfortable with technology, a lot of us going to take it and not even think. A lot of us going to have that mark and not even know it, because, oh, it's just another, it's just technology advancing. Well, this is why I'm teaching this. Because we need to understand, don't get too comfortable with it. Don't get too common with it. Don't say, well, you know, just y'all know we got to learn this technology. So you take it and you have it on you. And you're going to be able to move back and forth. You're going to be able to buy, sell, do business, but you're going to have that mark. But when Christ comes, you got that mark. You're not going to be saved with that mark. Because that says to Christ, you are part of the beast. You're part of the system. You're part of the world order that the enemy controls. Mm. So therefore, you are unfaithful. Though therefore, depart from me. I don't know you. Let's move on. And this.
Hallelujah.
Final song.
Amen, amen. Young people.
I was trying to stop it, but it kept going.
That's all right. Young people singing. That's that rejoicing
you were talking about.
Young people singing, He reigns forever. Yes. Despite what the devil is doing, will do. Christ gonna reign forever. Thank you for that, because we have to teach our young people that Christ will reign forever. Amen. Let us pray. Amen. Father God, we just want to thank you for this lesson. We want to thank you, Father, for all who participated. We want to thank you, Father, for all of those whose ears were tuned in. And Lord, we pray that you will protect us, Lord, from the tricks, from the tricks of the enemy. And Lord, even protect us from this technology, Lord, even though we appreciate what it's doing, but we pray that you would protect us, Lord, in the years to come, because we know that the enemy is cunning and we don't want any mark on us, Father, when you come, when your son Jesus Christ comes and take over the world. So we pray, Lord, that you continue to help us to stay vigilant when it comes to your word, your will, your way. We pray, Father, we continue to uphold the bloodstained banner. Help us to be effective witnesses. And Lord, we just want to thank you that you're still with us and you still in a miracle working business. And Father, we're still praying for Reverend James and Connie Walker. We're still praying for Sister Ann Parker and Reverend James Ingram. Father, don't forget Brother Charles Payne, Brother Tamar Hundley. Father, we're praying for Sister Sheila Bartlett, Sister Ruby Palmer. Father, don't forget Brother Clifton Gardner Jr. Continue to touch him from the crown of his head to the sole of his feet. Father, continue to comfort Sister Jean Hunter and family, Sister Lauren Atkinson, Sister Deborah Hawkins, and Sister Annette Banks, and Brother and Sister Minnie Robertson, Sister Barbara Harris, Father Reverend Roosevelt Knight and Anicia Holmes. Lord, don't forget Sister Kendra Good and Sister Annie Mae Davis and all of the sick and the shut-in and caretakers at First Baptist Church. Father, we thank you because we know you're in the miracle waking business. And Lord, whatever you do it well. And Lord, whatever you do it in a way, Lord, that shed light from your kingdom. And at this time now, we're going to call the names of those who I did not call. We ask that you touch them just the same. Let's call their names. Yes.
You can unmute yourself.
James Stevenson and family.
Principals.
Gloria Bruce.
Mr. Maker.
The Wright family.
John and Pat Griffith.
FBC family.
The Feaster family.
Vivian Ingram,
Marty Grove,
Gloria
Mack, Baptist Church family,
Preston Jones,
lift up,
Carrollton, our youth at school year,
all pastors, all leaders of the church, all members of the churches. God, come and help us to be, to take care of thy body. Their body is a sac, is a human sacrifice. Dear God, we must
many robbers
that belongs to you, Father. Give us the power to do what we need to do.
Lord God, our country.
Yes.
Yes. Political structure. Yes, Lord, because you, we see it. Protect us the way you want to and the way you know how. But believe we have faith in your Father. We appreciate all that you've done and all that you will do.
Yes.
Lord, you have heard the names that we have called. You have heard our concerns.
Yes.
Lord,
yes.
We lift up these names. We lift up our prayers and our concerns, Lord, because we know that you know how to work them out. We know, Lord, you know how to heal. We know, Lord, you know how to deliver. We know, Lord, you know how to touch. We know, Lord, you just know how to do everything.
Yes.
And so, Father, we just pray right now that you would just move among your people.
Oh,
and we ask, Lord, that you show yourself strong among
your people.
We ask, Father, that you just help the body of Christ to stay strong in these evil times in which we live. Yes, Lord, we're praying for America. We're praying for all of the nations of the world. Yes. We're praying for your people all over this entire world, on every continent. We ask, Lord, that you will remember your people. And then, Lord, remember First Baptist Church. And not only First Baptist, but every church represented here tonight.
Yes.
We are your people. We are the sheep of your pastor. And Lord, we thank you that you are our shepherd and we shall not want. Yea, though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we're not going to fear no evil, for thou art with us. And thy rod and thy staff, they comfort us. And thou preparest a table before us in the presence of our enemy. And thou anointest our head with oil. Our cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives. And we will dwell forever in thy presence and in thy kingdom. These and all blessings we ask in our son Jesus' name. And the people of God said, amen.
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 Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen.